Well, and didn't he record messages recently?
Yes, he did. That riddle as to his whereabouts. Previously, nag-alok pa siya ng 1,000 pisong premyo for the one who can guess where he is. My gosh, why do we have to guess? A warrant is an order of the court or of an institution to procure that person para humarap sa mga proper procedures. Itigil niya yung let's see how ganong kalakas ang loob niya kung nasa harap na siya ng Senado. Ulitin niya lahat ng mga pangiinsulto na yan. Hindi namin siya uurungan. He should stop insulting the Senate, the PNP, our people. We can see the wide and a very warm interest ng ating mga kababayan sa kasong ito. And he's making a mockery of all that.
And apparently, he is turning 74 years old soon. His birthday is coming up. And the members of the Kingdom of Jesus Christ is actually raising funds, buying gifts. So, I mean, the situation where you have a fugitive, there's a warrant for his arrest, and they're raising money for gifts.
Mm-hmm. And raising money seems to be a core preoccupation of Kiboloy kahit sa loob ng kanyang kingdom. Hindi ko pinagkakait sa mga miyembro niya to prepare gifts for him, to raise money for those gifts. Pero this issue is already wider and deeper and higher than all of that. All the legal accountabilities are on his head at dun sa 6 pang mga tao na pinangalanan sa mga kaso ngayon and who probably are also facing investigative and legal procedures sa ibang mga bansa. Halimbawa sa Estados Unidos, warrants were opened for him in a California court for 6 also serious crimes. At kung if the Interpol will step in, then it won't only be the FBI who has him on their most wanted list. Baka hindi lang sa US i-freeze yung assets niya. Kung mag-grant halimbawa yung whole departure order na hinihingi ng DOJ sa ating korte, kung hindi man mag-grant, there's another legal recourse, kanselahin yung passport niya. Then his passport and passport details will appear on the Interpol list as well. Mapipigilan siya sa kahit anong port of entry or exit. Di lamang dito sa Pilipinas, halimbawa sa visa ng isang whole departure order, pero sa kahit ano pamang jurisdiction sa buong mundo.
Okay. At this point, can you explain the extradition treaty? This is very important because we have one with the United States. Yeah. Unlike, for example, East Timor, right? Mm-hmm. With the situation with former Representative Arnulfo Teves. We don't have an extradition treaty with East Timor, but he was flagged by the Interpol and Parliament is making a decision whether he should be deported back into the Philippines. Mm-hmm. But there is a warrant against Kiboloy, technically speaking, with our extradition treaty. What is the responsibility of the Philippines with the U.S.?
Once, if and when the U.S. government makes an extradition request and it is received by the Philippine government, then yung gobyerno natin ay may karapatan at obligasyon sumagot one way or the other. Kung halimbawa, itutuloy ba muna yung mga kaso dito laban sa kanya kung mapa-appear na siya, the warm body of Apollo Kiboloy sa Philippine courts, tapusin muna yung mga kasong iyon bago siya i-extradite sa US o isususpend ba muna yung proceedings dito para mapauna na iyon or there may be other scenarios na kinoconsider ngayon ng gobyerno. I was able to ask the DOJ about that during one of our hearings. Pero ang sigurado ay if and when finally an extradition request comes through, then it will be a request considered between 2 countries na pareho nang may active proceedings against Kiboloy.
Another issue is, Senator, the team of Pastor Apollo Kiboloy is requesting that the trial or his case already be heard in Davao instead, right? In Davao. Mm-hmm. What is the effect if it's in Davao?
Well, the court will have to weigh that. Naalala ko yung unang mga kaso na hinain laban sa kanya by one of the victim survivors. It was dismissed. But ni-raise niya sa Department of Justice, which filed it in the courts here. At yun yung isang napagbigyan. At yun yung basehan ng isa sa mga warrants. So the court will have to weigh any such request from Kiboloy's party. And I'm sure that it will decide in the best interest of yung judicial process niya.
Mm. Should the president be issuing a statement already for the manhunt of Kiboloy?
He has already issued a few statements about related issues, which I appreciated at that point in time. Kaya lalong umaasa ako ngayon na mapa-epekto na ng PNP yung pag-aresto kay Kiboloy dahil yung pinakamataas na opisyal nila ng bansa sa ehekutibo ay nagkomento na rin sa kung gaano kaseryoso at nakakabahala no yung mga krimen na inaakusa kay Kiboloy. So sooner rather than later, he should face the questions and face accountability about them.
All right, let's move on now to the West Philippine Sea. I want to hear an overview of your take right now with our relationship with China.
Oh, we have an historic relationship thick with blood ties with China, not just between the Philippines and China separately geographically, pero yung maraming heritage at ugat natin, family ties din nga dito sa Pilipinas. My own maternal great-grandmother was pure Chinese. And we have a thriving Filipino-Chinese community right here in our country, centuries old as any of the other peoples in the country. Alam natin bilang mga Asyano how admirable are the accomplishments of China as a country in the past century or many decades. What gives us pause and really raises our blood pressure, hindi lang itong heat wave, ay yung more recent actuations ng China sa atin. And our necessity of pushing back and staking our claim in our national interest. So nandun yung China sa West Philippine Sea. Beijing is also too well represented in our national grid, in our telecoms. At ngayon, dito sa issue, one of the many issues that came out of our investigation of POGOs, 4 years in the running now, Karen, ay itong kaduda-duda talaga at nakakabahalang paggamit pala ng mga Chino ng mga Philippine official documents, birth certificates, passports, para kumilos at hindi lamang pala dito sa Pilipinas. The Philippine Embassy in Bangkok reported their alarm that 4 Chinese nationals posing as Filipinos holding Philippine documents were arrested in Thailand for criminal activity. So, kumbaga nagsasabog ng nagkakalat ng lagim hindi lang dito pati sa ibang ASEAN country at malay ba natin kung sa iba pang bansa sa mundo.
Okay, so you talked about the deep ties between the Philippines and China, right?
Yes.
Except now there's, some sectors have said there's rising xenophobia. Mm. That's already happening with discussions with, number one, the West Philippine Sea issue. Number two, just recently, the raid of a POGO in Tarlac. Mm. Where they brought in 5.5 million pesos and supposedly they were using fake Philippine documents. Yeah. And now the alleged influx of Chinese students into Gigaraw.
The Philippines has always been open to young people na gustong ditong mag-aral. Those student exchanges, welcoming of foreign students, builds dialogue, cooperation, understanding. Pero, at ito yung pinaka-take nung Senate resolution ko, ibang usapin. If any foreign nationals, studyante man siya o iba pa, POGO worker man siya o iba pa, gumagamit ng official Philippine documents, first, to commit criminal activity or to pose as Filipinos bilang cover ng kanilang criminal activity or to threaten our national defense right within our our borders. So kung yung mga estudyanteng biglang ang dami daw yun sa isang lalawigan, which happens to be close or is the site, a host of an EDSA site, EDCA site, at malapit pa sa Taiwan, one of the rising temperatures in our region. Kung mapatunayan yung mga dagdag na estudyante doon, natutong estudyante, di mabuti. Okay lang. Pero hindi naman siguro masamang magduda tayo o mag-alala because we can never be too careful and we have to keep our bases covered. Yung POGO Hub sa Tarlac, I conducted an ocular of that together with Senator Sherwin. My God, Karen, it's a 7-hectare property with 36 buildings built on it. The buildings that are dorms for their workers are 7 stories high. There are 14 villas on the property para sa mga Chinese bosses. And the cheapest of those villas was estimated by an architect to be worth 44 million pesos, fair market value. At yung ilan sa mga villa na doon ay may mga special features pa na talagang kaduda-duda kung talagang legitimate business operations lamang ang nangyayari doon. And of course, okay. The West Philippine Sea, yes.
So, but let's put it to 2 questions of that. Number 1, is the Bureau of Immigration remiss in its duties?
Yun yung tinanong din namin. Isa sa maraming tanong when we did that ocular in Tarlac. Because BI was remiss and called to account for the longest time on the Pastilla scam. Kaya napatanong ko rin, bagong kabanata ba ng Pastilla scam? Itong nagagamit ng mga di umanong estudyante, paying 1 million pesos daw to get into those universities, 80% for the ahente, 20% for the institution of higher learning. Ang BI ba ay kasangkot sa pag-access ng itong mga suspicious military-looking types daw sa isang village sa Paranaque? And then, yun na nga, yung mga Chino na aresto sa Thailand with Philippine passports and
birth certificates. Yes.
Diba? I mean, our national identity
and
is
using the birth certificate of dead people.
At it's so not just morbid, it's so cynical. Wala na bang sacred, no? Yung pagkatao ng tao na patay na at yung dignidad natin bilang isang bansa.
Uh-oh. But it also reeks of corruption in the agency. Because it's how would you source that?
How could we source that?
How would they be able to source?
Exactly. So matatanong talaga fairly na may insiders pa rin ba yung dating business model nila para sa visa upon arrival, corruption para sa Pastilla scam noon ay nag-reorganize lang pero aktibo pa rin yung mga dating ringleaders dyan. The other agencies na itinanong namin dati in an earlier POGO raid na stack ng mga PhilHealth ID, SSS ID, Pag-ibig ID, naka rubber band pa. So inihanda talaga. Paano ito nakukuha without the help of insiders tapos papagamit sa POGO o sa iba pang mga questionableng industriya na nandun yung mga dayuhang Chino using these Philippine documents.
Okay, now Senator, when it comes to POGO, what is the biggest challenge? What is hindering a total ban on POGO? Because ironically, the Chinese government issued a statement many, many months ago that they themselves are against POGO.
They are.
They don't have POGO in mainland China.
It's a crime in China.
It's a crime in China and they're against it because it corrupts their own people. So, ang tanong ko, why, what is stopping the Philippines from just issuing a total ban on POGO?
Exactly. Mukhang may mga policy and program tentacles from the previous administration na unang nagbukas ng bukas na bukas at sobrang mainit na nag-welcome nitong Philippine offshore gaming operations. Kung may policy feet or legs na tinatayuan itong POGO na ito, meron ng at least isang committee report na inilabas, Senate Committee on Ways and Means ni Chair Sherwin, calling for the ban of the POGOs within a very strict time frame of 3 months. At karamihan naming mga committee members ay pumirma dyan. Nira-wrap up ng aming Senate Committee on Women investigation, yung committee report tungkol sa POGO-related prostitution and all the crimes that followed our investigation against women and children, it's damning against POGO. Yeah. Wala kaming mabuting masasabi. Mm-hmm. Lahat ng rekomendasyon namin ay papunta din sa iba na yung POGO na yan. So that your question is my question too, Karen.
Yeah. Wouldn't it just take the president to issue the ban? President Marcos Jr. just announcing POGO is now completely banned in the Philippines.
He could. Kasi kung si Duterte noon ang nagbukas wide open ang mga pinto ng Pilipinas sa POGO, then si Presidente could also put his foot down and say we are banning POGOs and call upon the governmental and law enforcement authorities to enforce that ban. Lalo na tuwing raid upon raid, panay mga karumal-dumal ang nadidiskubre dyan.
And not only that, it doesn't even bring in the study show. It's not an economic game changer.
At all. It was a false promise. That's the irony. At lumabas yon sa committee report ng Senate Committee on Ways and Means. Ang liit-liit na mga proceeds dyan, ang laki-laki pa rin ng tax obligations nila. And then kung kaya nating i-quantify, i-monetize yung social cost sa ating bansa. Oh my God, the Senate Committee on Women could weigh in on that with 4 years worth of findings and recommendation. So sa balance sheet ng cost-benefit, walang-wala yung mga benefit na ipinangako noon na ang yabang-yabang at yung cost, napakatindi talaga.
So bago tayo magtapos, may panawagan ba kayo kay Pangulong Ferdinand Marcos Jr. pagdating sa POGO?
Well, I hope that the president knows that the Senate has been speaking for a few years already and more consistently na iban na yung POGOs. Kaya't kung magsalita si presidente laban sa kanila o mag-utos na ipasara na yan, tulad ng nagawa na ng mga past presidents sa iba pang mga malign na negosyo o industriya dito sa ating bansa, that will not hurt at all. That can only help our people.
On that note, Senate Deputy Minority Leader, Senator Risa Ontiveros, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you, Karen.